David, as we head into 2022, there is this backdrop of the Omicron variant, vaccinations, and some tightening measures. Give us an idea from your vantage point, some of the investing themes that emerged during the pandemic in 21 that'll carry over into this new year.
Sure. I mean, there's really two areas, you know, sort of what we would call the short-termisms and the long-termisms. And on the short-term side of things, you know, the theme is, of course, that markets don't like uncertainty generally, and we have nothing but uncertainty, and the news has really rattled the markets, as we've seen in the last number of days. Not all of it's bad. And so on one day we have this new variant and the market tumbles, and the next day we hear maybe it's not so bad, and then the market recovers quickly. So on a short-term basis, I think it's fair to say that we can expect generally volatility in the markets as the news continues to flow in, both good and bad. And I think also that folks that were making the recovery bet might find themselves having to really, especially they might have to buckle up for the ride. You know, all the people that thought what a great bet they made on, for example, travel stocks and other recovery bets might find that maybe it's not such a great place to be in the short term. Over the long term, I suppose, as we learn to live with COVID and its variants, because this is becoming much more of a marathon than a sprint, to be sure, the big theme must be, what does getting back to normal look like? And inflation. And that, of course, is something that, if, you know, every time we look at the Financial Post or any other news media outlet, we see right at the top, interest rates. But of course, that has a lot to do with inflation. And so I think that the biggest theme of 22 will be whether we really are seeing what, you know, the US Fed calls transitory inflation, meaning like a bounce back type of inflation when you flush the system full of cash, versus are we in a cyclical inflationary environment, which all investors should think about, because it's not necessarily bad, but it's something that you'd want to be able to predict with some level of granularity when you make your investment choices.
Let's just pick up on that a little and just dive into that. How are you investing in a time of inflation? I mean, the cost of living has shot up. You still want to shield your money. And I'm wondering whether or not there may be opportunities to take advantage of in that landscape.
Sure. I mean, let's remember what inflation is. I mean, we always argue that we all feel inflation before, you know, the government reports show that there is inflation, because we all know whether it's more expensive to buy a carton of milk or to fill up your car with gas in real time. And it's always a lagging indicator. But at the end of the day, food and rent are the two biggest contributors to CPI, to inflation, and how it's measured. And so if one believes, and almost everyone seems to be unanimous on it, which may mean that it won't come to pass, since very rarely do things that everyone's unanimous about come to pass. But assuming it does come to pass, you'd want to have that create wind in your sails rather than a headwind. And the way to achieve that is to invest in types of investments that are directly related to inflation rather than inversely related to inflation. So the best example of that are real assets. So infrastructure, income, real estate, farmland. And if you think about it, that makes sense, because they're collecting rent and they're selling food. And at its base element, those are the things that will go up in price to cause the very inflation that's being measured. So I'd rather own those things than be invested in, say, companies that have to buy things at higher prices or down the road, pay higher interest rates to borrow money.
I want to go back to one of the short-isms, as you had called them, and some of the strategies that we saw investors, I guess, take part in 2021 with respect to those, let's call them the stay-at-home stocks, tech, energy. Do you think those same strategies will work in 22?
Well, there's actually two sides to that coin. The stay-at-home stocks are the ones that bounce. Think about things like Peloton or Zoom that bounced a lot when we thought we might be home forever. And they actually have fallen a lot in recent months as slowly but surely the economy gets back to whatever the new normal looks like. The bounce back investments, which would be, say, airlines and cruise lines, have done very, very well as people believe that we will get back to, you know, some version of normal, especially with respect to travel. So the question will be, which side of the coin will we be on with the next variant and the one after that? So it seems like I'm oversimplifying, but those are trades, not necessarily investments. And a trade has a horizon, so that if you end up being right and you're smart enough to bet on a Zoom or a Peloton early in on the pandemic, maybe now would be a good time to close that and say, I did really well. That trade worked out. When it comes to investments, and I don't want to wade too far into the pool of value versus growth as an investment model, but what about owning, you know, banks and insurance companies and telcos, you know, the good old fashioned value investments that we used to call blue chip? They've done very well during the pandemic. They're doing well coming out of the pandemic. And I think that's because they fall under the category of value investing as opposed to opportunistic trading.
Let's pick up on a word that you had used a short time ago, rates and interest rate hikes proposed in the new year. How should investors navigate that?
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's interesting that in the last couple of days, people were bracing for higher and faster, meaning that rates would go up quicker than we thought and more than we thought. And the market was very uncertain, of course, about what that would mean, because higher rates generally means that the companies that make up the world's stock markets have to pay more input costs and therefore don't necessarily do as well. And then, of course, they came out, and so far the U.S. Fed has indicated that moving forward, they will be increasing rates, but not necessarily as highly as some people feared. And all of a sudden, they're saying, we're going to increase rates, but not as much as you might have thought. That was baked into the markets. And all of a sudden, the markets are on a tear. So the real question will come down to why the rates are going up. And I don't envy central bankers who have to play a game where they're trying to ensure that we don't go into a tailspin, that unemployment stays low-ish, but at the same time that inflation doesn't get out of control. And it's kind of like thinking about taking your foot off the gas when you're driving a car because you don't want to go faster and you'd like to go slower a little bit, but you don't want it to have the effect of having slammed on your brakes so that the car behind you slams into you. And that's sort of the dance that central bankers are doing right now. But in the big picture, to go back to sort of the genesis of your question, what don't you want to own in an increasing rate environment generally are bonds, because bonds generally have a fixed interest rate that they're paying you. And as rates go up, the value of your bonds go down. And so that is a core part of the vast majority of Canadians' investment portfolios. And that's a conversation that if I were listening to this interview, that I'd want to have with my financial advisor to say, I heard that if rates are going up, that my bond portfolio could suffer. What do you have to say about that? That's a conversation that is happening in the boardrooms of the largest pension funds all the way down to ordinary investors trying to achieve their objectives.
David, how do you think about global narratives affecting your portfolio in this upcoming year? When you think about our trading partners, the relationships that we have with them, current geopolitical issues, what's the knock-on effect to your portfolio?
And that's really a double-barreled question because we live in Canada. If we lived in the U.S., it would be all about the U.S. and the rest of the world, which is fraught enough on its own. But because we live in Canada, we don't only have to worry about how the U.S. fares with the rest of the world, but how we're faring with the U.S. because we're part of the rest of the world. And so what I mean by that is that when you read, for example, about the Build Back Better plan that is being pushed through the U.S. Congress, virus and the effect that that could have on Canadians. As we all know, the Canadians are up in arms over the energy parts of it, where they're going to be providing cash back to American consumers if and only if they buy electric vehicles that are manufactured in the US. It's a very inward looking plan that they have. And can you really blame them? Because they have a lot of pressure on them to achieve their internal objectives, but that's not good for Canada. And so what we have to worry about is our relationship with our neighbor, which also happens to be the world's superpower, on the proper footing. And then we hope that that superpower is able to deal with China and Europe and Russia and the rest of the world in a manner that can help us. And the final thing I'll add to that is that one of the ways in which we see the feedback about how that game within a game is really going is foreign exchange. And that, again, I talked about a dance that the central bankers have to do. Another dance when you're running, you know, a country not called the United States of America is to ensure that your currency doesn't become too expensive or too cheap versus their currency, because that can have very significant impact, both positive and negative, I might add, depending whether you sell or buy in US dollars, on Canada's future. So there's a lot of work to be done, but I would certainly go on the record as saying that a good relationship with our neighbor to the south is always better than a bad relationship with their neighbor to the south, because they're the elephant and we're the mouse.
David, lastly, as the world transitions to net zero, or rather countries around the world propose to transition to net zero, give us an idea of how important of a component is ESG in investing.
Very important. And I'll tell you a practical answer to that. I personally believe it's important because I would like my kids to have a nice world to live in. But even if you leave the altruistic part out of it, it's important because it's important to the world's largest investors. And because the largest investors, for example, all the sovereign funds across the world that have hundreds of billions of dollars to allocate into the capital markets, care deeply, and now it's being written right into their mandates that ESG is very important. As an ordinary investor, that's a very important clue as to what it is that they're going to be doing in the future. And to the extent that one believes that they're good at investing, and they usually are, following what the biggest investors are doing is usually good for your pocketbook at the end of the day. So that you have a double-barreled goodness here, which is that the world becomes a better place, but also you can do well as an investor by following the biggest investors. I think that we've crossed the Rubicon from having to give up investment returns in order to help save the world to being able to do well and do good at the same time, not a phrase that I coined, which is that you can do well from an investment point of view while you're also trying to reduce the footprint across the world and get better governance across the world and decrease income inequality and many of the other things that could come along with saving our planet. And that is a theme that will grow substantially very quickly because the biggest investors care so deeply about it.